So thanks for having me here. My name's Eleanor Power. I'm an anthropologist. I just got my PhD at Stanford University. Before that, I used to do archaeology. My undergrad was at Brown University. And I was interested in exploring those sort of big transitions in human history to sedentary living, to state societies, and the rest. And one of the features that's often brought up when exploring those big transitions is religion. And I got particularly interested in that. But religion poses this puzzle. If you're coming from an evolutionary perspective, from a rational actor perspective, basically, why do people do things like this? How do we fit something like this into a rational actor evolutionary perspective? This is taken from where I work. As an anthropologist, I duly went to study this question of sort of the puzzle of religion, of what religion does in society in an absurdly specific setting, which is two small villages in South India. And to get a sense of the role that religion plays in society, how it might influence people's position, their ability to get by in life, and things like that, I gathered information on over 2 years of field work on people's social position. So first, things to do with their reputational standing. So this shows how reputation can vary across the life course for a number of the different qualities that I gathered information on. And then also social support network data. So I can ask questions like, given the nature of people's religious participation, how do people relate to that person? Is a person more likely to ask someone for support across a different variety, different types of support if that person, say, engages in impressive public ritual acts like this piercing here, or in the more mundane but consistent act of worshiping regularly? So those are some of the questions that I've been investigating, and thankfully coming to a wonderful place like SFI, I've now been able to engage in a lot of nice collaborations to ask broader questions about really just the feedbacks between social structure and religious practice. So for example, I'm looking at the role of collective worship in shaping social structure. So on the left here, we have the social network of emotional support for one of the villages that I work in. Here it's colored by caste, but now here it's colored by religious community. And you can see, so we have Catholics, Protestants, and Hindus there as well. So you can see how much the religious denomination structures the network there. So what role does collective worship, people worshiping together, play in that? So I'm working on that with Katerina DiBacco, Chris Moore, Dan Larimore, and Laurent. And then at a more individual level, what's the relationship between individual social capital and their ability to undertake these dramatic religious acts that I've observed in the villages that I work in? So what this is showing on the right there is essentially the change in a person's reputational standing given their social capital beforehand. And while it's not the clearest of graphs, generally what you can see is that as you have greater social capital and greater reputational standing, the boost you receive from doing these dramatic ritual acts increases. So there's something like a sort of a feedback and potentially even something like a poverty trap where people who are already better off gain more, and similarly people who are less well off in terms of social position gain relatively less from undertaking what are essentially the same acts. So those are some of the questions that I'm looking at. Those also involve a lot of collaborations with people both at SFI like Marion Dumas and people outside of SFI. And I'm just gonna leave it there so we can actually get through everyone here, so I'm happy to take any questions that you might have. Thanks.
Any questions here? I was wondering about social capital and benefit from grandstanding acts and presidential campaigns. You have any plans to?
No. That's rich material right there. So one of the main things I would say that I observed in my 2 years of fieldwork in these villages is that the audience is extremely skeptical. And any evidence of sort of bravado and overinflation of yourself is going to be looked upon with suspicion. And can be easily, you know, you're gonna bring that person down to size. I think that certainly has relevance.
Oh, would that we could.
Yeah, would that we could. And, you know, I think when the eyebrows are raised, you know, there's that happens everywhere. I think we're well aware of that. Okay. Yeah.
Anyone else? David?
Who are you?
Oh, I'm David. Yeah. What do you think is causal? I mean, so you have this, you know, is it social driving the religious or the religious driving the social?
As a good anthropologist who is unwilling to make any strong claims, I'm going to say it's both. I think these, you know, I'm more likely to go to a religious ceremony because my friends are going, and now that my friends are there, I'm more likely to have stronger relationships with them. This is certainly, you know, it all feeds back on itself. So what I'd like to do to address that more properly, because what I have right now is essentially static data, is go back and collect further network information, probably across two or three more time periods over a number of years, so I can look and actually ask more properly some sort of causal relationship there. But right now, it's hard to tease those apart.
There was a hand back up there first. I can't remember. Was it? Yeah.
Tim Kohler, archaeologist. So what you're describing here should be, I think, a runaway process, right? But it's not. Why is it not a runaway process?
In part because I think there are going to be natural limitations on people's sort of social maneuverability, in a sense. There's only so much reputation you can gain. And I think these sort of leveling mechanisms are going to play a pretty crucial role in bringing people down to size to some degree. You can't... I think the dot on the very far right in this plot there is indicative of that. That person, you can't quite get it from this plot there, but that person has essentially hit the top limit of reputational standing. They're already being recognized by something like 50% of the village. And you're just because of the sort of structural realities, like, for example, the clustering of this network that you have on the left here, it might be hard to essentially go beyond that. And it's just, you know, once you've become this sort of grandiose person who is maintaining a large social network, maintaining all those ties is going to be a hard thing to do. There's just going to be sort of time investments and the rest to keep those relationships going. That's going to be hard to maintain at higher levels than that.
We should do one more quick one.
Sure.
You guys can...
Whoever wants to fight for it, go.
Go ahead. I'll be really quick so maybe he can get into it.
Who are you?
Josh Wolf, real quick. I'm wondering if you can also be predictive if there are splintering effects where somebody who recognizes that they're not going to be the high reputation alpha person might decide to form their own religion, offshoot.
Ooh. Ooh. Yeah, I mean, sociologists have looked into that. They call it the church sect process. There's a reason here I'm talking about social capital and distinguishing it from status or reputation, because I think those are two very different things. Whereas very few people can be the prestigious, prominent individuals, everybody is going to have some degree of social capital. So I think that allows us to look at the maneuverings of individuals across all ranges of standing and position that lets us get a more complete idea of people's social strategies.
No, in order that we actually have the last postdocs able to take some questions, I think we should move on. So thank you very much.
Thanks.
Excited to be here today. I'll tell you a bit about some work that I've been cooking up recently with some folks at SFI on ranked communities in networks. As background, I got my PhD at the University of Colorado in applied math. And then I went to Harvard School of Public Health, where I worked in the Center for Communicable Disease Dynamics as a postdoc for 3 years. I think, as you know, SFI is a place where ideas tend to collide with each other. So here are two things that I've worked on that are now colliding, and I'm really excited about it. On the left, I'm showing you a network where we were exploring malaria's ongoing evolution by looking at community structures and networks. On the right, I'm showing you just a figure from how we were exploring prestige and inequality and bias in faculty hiring networks, where we were gaining insights from the ordering of the vertices. So on the right, we have the community structures. On the left, we have the orderings. And now these two concepts are smashing together in a fun collaboration with Laurent and Ellie. I'm showing you three photos here that I Google image searched about high schools and cliques. And I'm wondering if one of these groups you may identify with more than the others. On the left, you've got the person with the letter jacket and the cheerleader. In the middle, you've got the chess club. And on the right, you've got folks who are wearing quite a bit of black clothing and high boots. One interesting thing that happens when you ask people to nominate others in their social network is that I might declare that Ellie is my friend, but Ellie might not do the same, right? There's an asymmetry here the networks that we create in these social networks are directed. And if you have lots of directed connections, you have the possibility of ranking in addition to community structure. So the question for this project was, we organize ourselves into groups, but do we also order those groups? And if we did, if we were given network data, how would we know if we had those community structures that are also ordered? So now generalizing, if we have a network of directed edges where we have, say, the cool kids and the not so cool kids, what if these networks have groups that are ordered or ranked? How would we automatically discover that kind of structure in the networks? And if we develop those sorts of algorithms, can those methods accommodate links that mean endorsement versus links that mean dominance? So let me tell you what I mean here. If you and I are in the same community and the link between us is an endorsement link, then it makes sense for the link to be in the same community. However, if that link is a link of dominance, it makes sense for us to be in separate communities. So depending on the meaning of the link, the way that we define ranked community structure may vary. So this is work with Laurent and Ellie, and I'm just going to show you an example using some of Ellie's data from the exact same social networks that she just presented. On the right, I'm showing you a division of her network of endorsement divided into three communities. And the question is, how strongly do these ordered communities in this Indian social network organize by caste? These are colored by caste, and you can see that the mapping between caste and the community structures is imperfect. Now, this is known ethnographically, but for the first time, we're trying to look at real social network data to see how the rankings and how the actual social ties transcend caste. And we're interested in a few other things. Are U.S. high schools organized by some sort of caste system? Are the cool kids actually cool? Can we apply these methods to food webs and look at trophic levels? Can we apply these kind of methods to animal behavior where animals assert dominance over each other? And when we look at concepts of university prestige, are there actually tiers of prestige, or is it more like a strict ordering of prestige? So I'd love to answer any questions that you have. Thanks.
Can you say a bit more about these university hiring networks, how they were constructed?
Yeah, so this is actually an SFI-related collaboration. We were interested in the flows of PhD graduates into faculty jobs. So you can create a network in which the nodes are universities, and I have a directed flow from one university to another if somebody got a PhD at the first university and is now faculty at the other. And so from this, you can see a clear, strict, and strong hierarchy of prestige and how the universities are essentially endorsing each other's programs when they hire each other's graduates.
Yeah. Will you tell us what the node with the highest degree is outgoing?
In faculty hiring?
Yeah.
It depends on the field, actually. But you can explore data if you want. We have some nice visualizations.
Cool. Any other questions? No. Okay, well, let's move on. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Brendan Tracy, and I'm a postdoc here at the Santa Fe Institute, joint with the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. I just finished up my PhD in July in the Department of Aeronautics and Astronautics at Stanford. And while I'm doing a bunch of different things here at the Santa Fe Institute, my primary focus is on multi-information source optimization. So what does that even mean? So when you're designing these complex engineering systems, such as an airplane, there are lots and lots of different trade-offs that come in. And one dimension of these trade-offs is what we call these disciplinary approaches. So an airplane is this multidisciplinary system that's a big trade-off between all sorts of different interests. And now at the same time, there's a lot of theory that goes in each of these different boxes, and scientists have developed many different approximations to each of these. So say in the specific case of aerodynamics, we can say we know exactly how fluids move, and I can tell you the right answer in 10,000 years. That's not very useful when we're trying to design a system. And so instead, there's this hierarchy of different assumptions that have been made in order to make the time cheaper. And so what we end up with is a big trade-off between high-fidelity models that take a long time to run but give us the answer, we're a good enough answer for what we're looking for, and then low fidelity models, which can run very, very quickly, but are only approximations to the answer. And so this happens, say, for each of these different disciplines, and now we have this multidisciplinary system, and we need to integrate it. So the question is, given this information-rich environment, how do we design algorithms that can take these information sources and find a good design? And so traditional optimization algorithms are not good enough for this approach. Generally, they assume that you have a black box function, or if you're lucky, maybe not so black box. But there's a set of inputs, and the optimization algorithm, say, guesses different sets of inputs to try to maximize the output quantity of interest. And this has been very successful so far. I'm sure many of you have run an optimization. But what we need to look at is in this multi-information environment. So in particular, say, multi-fidelity optimization, where we do have this trade-off that I mentioned. And what we want to do is figure out where to evaluate such that by the end of the time we're done, we can find good things. And so if the design is going to be bad, we don't want to spend 2 days running our big expensive simulation to evaluate it. But how do we know that this design is bad before we run that simulation? And so in particular, I'm studying this in what we call a Bayesian optimization framework. And in particular, I'm looking at the problem of look ahead. So let's say we have a computational budget of 2 weeks in order to run this. Maybe we want to favor running our cheap approximation algorithm and only have a couple of times running these two-day simulations. But we have 2 weeks to do this, so we don't want to every time say, okay, this design I think is good, this design I think is good. At the beginning of the process, we probably want to evaluate places that we think are going to be informative. So we know they're going to be bad, but they tell us a lot about how these systems behave. And so we want it to be that by the time we're done with the optimization, now we've found a good design. So there's a trade-off between exploration and exploitation. And so we're working on algorithms to do this sort of in an optimal setting. And in the future, we're looking to expand these techniques say to bigger scale problems, and we need to make approximations to our sort of even optimal algorithms. Thank you.
You're good.
Working. I wonder how general the problem is, maybe more general than just multi-information sources. But for example, if you're playing chess, the computers are designed now so that you don't just search the whole tree. You have to decide which part of the tree you're going to source. And so you look further down some paths than you look down other paths. And you're under a time constraint about how long you can be calculating and so on. It sounds like a very analogous problem. Do you think some of your techniques might apply to something so simple as how to program a computer to play chess and which paths to examine and which ones not to?
Yeah, so I'm not sure about the direction into chess, but certainly taking the algorithms that they use and bringing them into our problem. So one of the big difficulties in playing these games, say chess or Go, is the state evaluation. So how good is this thing? And one thing that's really nice about the engineering context is we can say, like, this is what makes a good airplane. So what we can do then is, it turns out, like in chess, we're pretty good at defining the state evaluation function. And so we can do kind of a nice broad tree search on how it works. Whereas in the case of Go, say AlphaGo, one of its big things was trying to figure out a better state approximation function and more efficient ways of navigating this really big tree. And so in our problem, the way we framed it, we have an extremely huge tree, and it's not even possible to do one step with all of the things you could do because we're working with real numbers. And so we need to find ways of sort of coarsening the set of all real numbers into the set of interesting real numbers, and then from there, trying to figure out how to go sort of deeper by being smarter than just look at all of them two steps out. We want to be able to be smart about navigating that tree, say using techniques like Monte Carlo tree search.
Andres?
So when you run to catch a ball that's thrown at you, you think that your brain is computing the equations of motion, which are complicated, to try to calculate the position of the ball. But it turns out that that's not actually what's happening. Your brain is computing some very simple heuristics that are both fast and accurate. And so I'm wondering whether, you know, this observation from cognitive psychology translates into your domain. You know, is it possible that this trade-off between accuracy and speed is not necessary? That there's actually, if you have the right kind of heuristics, a lot of these computations that are very time-consuming to get right accurately could actually be much faster.
Yeah, so there are a couple of answers to that. So on the one hand, in this work, we're sort of starting that the information sources that you have are fixed, but what you can do is do things like create surrogate models, such as the ones that Artemy is looking at, and these surrogate models act like these heuristics, where like they're pretty good generally, you hope, and maybe they're wrong sometimes, and then you want to fix them. Another answer to that question is a lot of the work that I did in my PhD, which is saying maybe if we are better about how we approximate the physics, we can end up with models that are almost as accurate, but much, much cheaper. And so I think you can attack that problem from various fronts. So in the one case, exactly what I talked about is just being smarter about which ones we use, so only using the cheap ones when we need it because they're pretty good heuristics. The second level is for the ones times that we really do need it, you can generate surrogate models, which are sort of dynamic approximations. And then the third level is let's just change the models to begin with by going deeper into the physics, or what I was looking at was trying to use machine learning and big data to keep as much of the physics as you possibly can while supplementing with data those little cores that we don't know how to do better yet.
Okay, great. Well, thank you very much. Thank you again.
Hello, I'm Vanessa Ferdinand, and I got my PhD at the University of Edinburgh at the Center for Language Evolution on the only sunny day in Scotland, as you see in the picture there. My dissertation was on the topic of regularization, which is how learners create structure in language. When people learn a language with some variation in it, like two words for one object, they tend to produce less variation when you test them on that language. And one neat thing I found in my PhD is that regularization is not specific to language. People compress non-linguistic variation similarly, like when they have to guess what kind of marbles are coming out of what jars. So this means that the structure that we see in language is rooted in basic cognitive mechanisms for perceiving and processing and producing the variation we see in the world around us. The main question I'm working on at SFI is how do these kind of cognitive constraints shape culture? So say we have a ball of clay, and this ball of clay is something that's culturally transmitted, like the English language or rock music or how to make your favorite Neolithic stone tool. And say that this language or cultural thing is going to be learned by several generations of people. And now imagine that we take that clay and bounce it off of everyone's heads one by one. Each learner is going to make some kind of impression on that clay. And what I want to know is, what is that ball of clay going to look like in the end? In other words, how does a cognitive system and all of its learning biases shape and structure the cultural artifacts that replicate through it? So I have three methods for solving this problem. First, I use information theory as a common currency for quantifying the structure in sequences and language and grammar, and then relating changes in the structure to particular compression strategies. And second, I run artificial language learning experiments on real human learners so that I can train them on specific types of variation and see exactly how they compress that variation. And third, I plug this data into cultural evolution models so I can figure out what structure the human data would take after several generations of learners. Basically, any cultural evolution model would be one that takes the output of one learner and turns that into the input for the next learner. So like the broken telephone game is a cultural evolution model. And I also like to borrow models from population genetics and ask, if a cognitive bias is a selection pressure, what kind of selection pressure is it? And if we know what our cognitive biases are, can we predict changes in language over time? Or is drift a major force in cultural evolution? And one of the neat things I found so far is that humans are great at detecting patterns in the world around us, but we're also great at hallucinating patterns too, and compressing data according to rules that actually are not there. And all this gets very cool in the context of cultural evolution because it means that one person's error can easily become the next person's rule. Thank you very much.
Questions? So I noticed these are all made up words. I assume that's something about your experimental design that's very important.
It is. I always work in an artificial language learning paradigm because if you ask people about words in English, they've been exposed, so all of you have been exposed to a sample of English, but I don't know exactly what that sample looks like. So I want to know what variation I've given my participants. So we'll use words that people don't know in their native language and also objects that people don't readily have a word for so that we can kind of put some sort of controls on that kind of a paradigm, yeah.
Any other questions? All right, David.
Yeah, great. And so there are individual biases, cognitive constraints that are reflected at the cultural level, but there are also collective biases that manifest at the cultural level. Have you looked at that too, not just the brain's impact on the evolution of culture, but community and social structures' impact on the evolution of culture?
Yes, some people in my field have looked at that. So I would, I like to take a micro approach and then try to build up and say, well, what would the macro, like how could we step back and describe the system? But I would like to understand how the macro level patterns get there in terms of the micro level processes that are going on. And some a way that I do approach this is I tend to think that, okay, we do have these individual learners and they're embedded in a learning context. So if somebody is embedded in a particular social structure, they might behave differently. So I do try to reduce, I try to be a reductionist about this, and I reduce it down to the individual learner. Like there's a nice experiment that one of my colleagues did where they showed people the same, it was an artificial language learning experiment where you got the exact same distribution of variation. In one condition, it came from the same voice. It was the same speaker producing all that variation. And the second condition that that variation was coming from two different voices. So one voice was producing a particular kind of variation, another was producing the other, but they still summed to the same overall variation. And people did very different things in both of those experiments. They were able to maintain more variation when it came from two different people, say like a Australian speaker and an American English speaker. You might think, okay, well, you have your style, you have your style, and I can learn about those things. It's easier to learn conditioned variation. This is one of the main findings here. So if you give someone a conditioning context, which could be any social factor, like condition on someone's prestige, or people will be able to maintain that variation better. So you do get different outcomes, but I can reduce that back to the learning context, and then say, given this learning context, what does it look like in these particular social structures?
Thank you. Many of you know this, but between noon on April 4th and noon on April 7th, a very interesting thing happened at the Santa Fe Institute. The postdocs got together and decided that in 72 hours, they would formulate, explore, and write up an idea. And it was published on the archive at 11:59 a.m. on the 7th. It's called The Dynamics of Beneficial Epidemics. The question was, how do dynamics of beneficial biological and social epidemics differ from those of detrimental epidemics? There were three ground rules that this group assigned themselves. Paper has to be on the archive by 11:59. Fresh ideas only, not somebody's pet idea that he ropes everybody else in to work on. And we're in this together. Everybody is involved. So I would like to ask everyone who was involved in this project to come up on stage while I finish talking about this. The SFI supported this. They rented these folks a house and circled around to support them. David apparently came with bourbon and chocolate. Yeah.
At
the right times, and coffee. So the goal was really here to challenge the traditional time constant of science, and this was a really magnificent thing, and I'd like to thank all the people who do this and encourage you guys to read this paper. It's fabulous. So, thanks.
And just to add, there are a couple of more people who are involved that are not here today, so just keep in mind that this is not exclusive.
Okay. And I'd like to add, this was Chris Kempis' brilliant idea.
Which very quickly became a group idea.
Anyway.
Yeah, I think one of the unexpected outcomes was just how efficient everyone became. So I think, one of the reasons we do science is it's really fun to explore tangents and to try and understand the overall space of what you're trying to do. And here it was very much like the clock's ticking, what's the result we can get to quickly that we really believe that's really interesting. And so there was just a real efficiency and a real sort of cooperation because people realized that having a pointless argument with someone really was going to delay things rather than make it go forward. I think the other thing that we learned really was the value of the slow part of science. So I think every one of us the next day when we were driving around thought, why didn't I make that connection? Why didn't I think of that paper? You know, this is something that's similar, that talking about it in different language, and we should really weave that in. And so I think after the fact, we've had a lot of ideas and places where we could expand, and that's really where the slow part of science comes in. So any other main takeaways?
I did not expect us to so seamlessly organize ourselves into groups that then would share ideas and make it all come together. I thought it would be a lot more hectic than it was. I don't know why. I don't know the explanation.
And I will say another really great outcome is that there are, so we, as it was mentioned, like we didn't know what project we were going to do ahead of time. And the first, depending on how you count, 6 to 18 hours, we're trying to figure out exactly which question we're going to be asking. But the very first part of that, the first 2 hours, were many people coming up and saying, here's a thing that I've been thinking about only loosely, and like maybe we could ask this question. And so like that was really beneficial, but at least 2 or 3 of the ideas were like, actually, no, that's a really cool idea and we should do it. And so there are at least 3 and possibly more follow-on projects that are happening, both with the exact paper we wrote and also with the other ideas that came up during the original discussion.
Okay, well, thank you again. Go ahead.
Interested in how small groups organize themselves. Would you be willing to share whether or not, I think there's maybe 12 of you, including those who aren't standing up there. A group that size, it's hard for them to operate without a subgroup structure or without a leader. How did you solve this problem?
So we're working on writing up something about our exact experiences, sort of a formula for replication if we wanted to do this in the future, and lessons learned. We did subdivide, but I think one of the things that really made it work, and you guys can agree or disagree, and this is gonna paint me as like a real softy, but like trust and friendship were huge. Like if I needed help on something, I knew that I could pull somebody else in and that person would gladly, you know, take over some of the driving, some of the research, some of the lit review. And I think at the same time, when somebody finished a task, that person would just go around and say, like, what needs to be done? Where can I help out? And so this way, we really organized pretty well, and everybody was incredibly cooperative. So I learned a lot about, like, trusting the other postdocs and being friends. Like, we had a great time.
One more question there.
Back on the self-organization question and the trust, et cetera, how big a group do you think it would have worked for?
So we had 15 all told. I think much bigger than that could be hard. So probably 20 is too big. Probably 10 starts to be at the lower end of what could work. Just because there's, you know, a lot of hands needed for various tasks, and just, you know, the last 8 hours was very hectic, and so that really was, everyone needed to be doing something. So there is a person capacity part of that. So 15 seems pretty optimal, but it'd be fun to test that with, you know, bigger. Yeah.
And then the last question, Barbara.
Barbara Gross, and I'm gonna do this as a shout out for the Institute, but you guys can disagree. I just wanted to acknowledge the amount of respect that built among you before you went off on this. It's just a hallmark of the Institute for people with coming from different backgrounds, and also to commend you for all the work you did ahead of time, not on the problem, which you never talked about, but on how to make a group process work. And I think, as some of you know, I couldn't believe you'd really stay awake for 72 hours, let alone really be able to do this. And I think that, you know, I applaud you, and I think all the work ahead of time really shows.
Yes, this is just fabulous. So thank you very much for doing it.